welcome to another broadcast from Evangel Worship Center in Marianna, Florida. Our service times are Sundays at 9:30 a.m., Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m., and our office is open 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. For more information about our church, visit our website at evangelonline.net or call 850-526-2232.
Ashamed to praise him this morning. Amen. Come on, sing it.
Come on, let's turn it up. We're gonna sing it out for all the world to hear. Oh, 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 oh. There's time for everyone. A new day has begun. Something to shout about.
Sing it out.
Let it be.
To my rescue, calling on your name, calling on your name. I am yours.
sing that.
So I shout out to
Him. Let me hear you.
From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours.
All that I am, Lord.
All that I am, I place into your loving hands. And I am.
Shame this morning, just raise your hands and praise Him in this place.
God,
we come to bless you this morning.
Yes, we do. Praise you, Jesus.
Come on, how many come this morning not just to have church but to experience the presence, the anointing, the power of God this morning? Amen. Jesus, how many is hungry for a move of God this morning? Amen. You know, how many of you ever been around someone that has, they've maybe not eat for a long time. They're just starving. You know what I'm saying? They're hungry.
Mom.
How many knows that when they ever have a chance to eat, they're not really worried about what somebody else thinks about them, okay?
Yeah.
If they use their hands, they use their hands. If they get a little bit on them, they get a little bit on them. How many understands what I'm saying?
Yes.
I'm just saying, this morning, I can tell you that I'm hungry for God. I guess what I'm trying to say this morning is, I don't know about you, but I get tired of just coming to church just for the form of having church, okay? But I'm not talking about your style of worship. You know, how many knows worship's not about a style? It's not about music. And worship is not slow songs, okay? But worship is what you do. It's what you are. It's what we actually come in here to do this morning. And I don't know about you, but we have all... If you look, I want to invite the next song. This next song talks about blessing the Lord. And I want to invite anybody that wants to bless the Lord this morning to come up to this front like the rest of them. Look, I'm not talking about worshiping God in a style. You know how some people stay there in their pews and they hit the back of their pew. And you know what? They're worshiping in their hearts just as much as somebody who's raising both of their hands. It's not about how you worship. Please understand that. I'm not saying, and if you don't, it doesn't mean you're not worshiping God just as much. Okay? All I'm asking this morning is if you worship like this, just push it just a little bit. You know, get to right here. Just step outside your box because God is here and God wants to move in this place this morning. And for this next song, when it says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul," anybody that wants to say, "God, it's not about me this morning, but I come to bless you. I come to worship you. God, if you never do anything else for me, you've already done more than I could ever thank you for. But God, right now, for the next 5, 6, 7, 10 minutes, I'm just going to come give you praise. I'm going to bless you this morning. I'm going to thank you for who you are." Amen. Come on, sing this with me.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, summer may pass, and whatever lies before me, let me be seen when the evening comes.
Come on, bless him.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. For my heart to find,
a heart to find,
yeah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. And then forevermore.
Oh, come on.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, I worship His holy name.
Oh, I
sing like never before. Worship Your holy name.
Come on, all over this place, just praise Him.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name.
Come on, sing it out.
Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name.
Come on, sing that out again. Bless the Lord. Let me hear you.
Bless the Lord.
And this morning, I've got a very simple message, and it is about your identity. Your identity in who God is. I want you to watch this as we get ready to worship God this morning.
Oh, it is.
How many of you have something in your wallet or in your purse or in your car? Or let's say something right with you that gives you an identity. If I was to come up to you and I say, Derek, have you got something that some ID on you? Would you have some ID on you? What would you have? Your driver's license. Yeah. You know, we could go around to a lot of people, and I looked in my wallet before I came in, and I thought, you know, if someone asked me for a piece of ID, how many would I have? And right off the bat, I pulled out six different things that tell something about me, where someone could probably check and find out who I am. Because identification is a big thing. You get pulled over, what's the first thing they ask you? Somebody's been there before. Girlfriend, you gave the whole list. That was good. That was good. Proof of insurance, registration, all that type of stuff. You know, we all, when we, you know, something like that, we see those lights, our heart stops, and the first thing we start doing is digging for ID, you know, because we know they want to know who we are. That identification tells a lot about you. It tells your date of birth, which a lot of times we put our thumb over that, and, you know, as we hand it to them. It tells how long that you can drive with this license. If you look for your registration, it talks about who the registered owner of the car is. All of those types of things. I was driving down the road the other day, and I thought, oh, crud. You know, I was thinking about one of my pieces of identification. I'm like, I wonder if this thing has went out, if it's expired. So I got to a place, and I pulled it out, and it doesn't go out till like, you know, 2016 or a little bit further, and I'm like, okay, I'm good on this one. But the reason I had to pull it out is because I hadn't checked that identification in a while. How many of you has ever got pulled over or had to display your license and they go, you know this is out of date, don't you? Or what about our tag? I found out, I didn't realize this, that you know, I thought when it said like it goes out, you know, 7 of this year, you know, I thought it was good for the whole month. Yeah, not. Good to your birthday, you know, of that. And I'm like, okay, that's good to know. So now I check that quite often. And I've had different officers. We got officers working here, and they'll come up and they go, Pastor, I don't know whose car this is, but here's their name. You may want to let them know their tag has expired like about 4 months. They're about to lose their identity of that car. You see, our identity is really important to us. And one of the things that we see happening a lot is identity theft. Identity theft. People stealing your identity and going on vacation, and they're saying, thank you very much. People buying all of these different things, you know, because they steal our identity. And it's very important we find out they have these different things that you can buy now that alert you if someone uses your identity or if someone tries, you know, to use one of your cards or something like that. And I began to think this week about how important my identity in Christ is. I got a question for you. When's the last time that you thought about your identity in Christ? When's the last time you thought, I hadn't talked to him in a good while. Lord, we're still good, right? Our identity in Christ is very important. And that is one of the areas that the enemy attacks very often. I don't know about you, but I've had the enemy say to me, you know God doesn't love you. If God loved you, you wouldn't be going through all this junk. If God loved you, you wouldn't be suffering. If Christ really loved you, if the Holy Spirit, the power that you talk about was real, you would be just busting through all of these trials and all of these temptations and all of these different things. You would be better than this. You see, we get locked up in the thing of, if I am a Christian, then bad things don't happen to me. Are you ready? Yeah, like that's wrong. Because I have to go back to Jesus Christ, the Word who became flesh and dwelt among us. He was the very life of what this talks about. He lived so that we can live. He went through difficulties. And I don't know about you, but the last time I read the scripture, Jesus Christ was beaten. Jesus Christ was mocked. Jesus Christ was made fun of by the religious organizations, by all of these other types of things. Religion will wound you. A relationship with Christ will set you free. And I have to know who I am in Christ. I have to remind the enemy when he comes in and he tries to tell me, you're a no good rotten dog. If you really loved God, you wouldn't make these mistakes. You wouldn't trip over these things. Well, you know, I find a lot of the disciples in Scripture having to deal with difficulties. I remember one of them where Jesus looked at him. He goes, get behind me, devil. Now, I don't know about you, but Jesus calling me Satan, that kind of messed me up. He looked at him. Why? Because he was trying to bring him back in to the thought pattern of, you're getting out of lines. You're thinking carnal. You're not thinking in the spiritual realm. You've allowed the enemy to shift you over, and I've got to shock you back into the place where you go, whoa, yeah, that's not a right thought pattern right there. And a lot of times, we've got to go through difficulties. We go through trials. We go through different types of things. And the enemy is trying to defeat us in our identity with Christ. But through all of that, Christ is trying to tell us, I've come to show you that I am greater than anything you will ever go through if you will put your trust and faith in me. I will bring you through this. My mind this week, I was in Romans chapter number 8. Very familiar passage of Scripture. And read this along with me. It says, so there is no, everybody say no. No. Say it again. No. Does that mean there is any? No. It means there is none. There is no condemnation. No beating down of the enemy. No believing the lies. No feeling worthless. There is no condemnation for who? Those who belong to Christ Jesus. My identity. When I know that I belong to Christ Jesus, how do I know? If I ask Him to come into my heart and believe that He is Lord and Savior and ask Him to forgive me of my sins, He comes into my heart. There's an old song, some of you may remember it, in the Redback Hymn Book. Anybody know what the Redback Hymn Book is? That was the sacred law for many years in the church. The old Redback Hymn Book had a song, and some of you may know it, there's a new name. See, y'all know it. Y'all as old as dirt, too. Said, I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. And then it goes on, goes to the chorus. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home. I'm not going to sing it. It's a testament. Sometimes I've got to go back when the enemy tries to condemn me, when the enemy tries to tell me, you've lost it with God, you've left it. Let me tell you something, the love of God is far greater than the condemnation of the enemy. I'm going to say that again. The love of God is far greater than the condemnation that the enemy can place on you. He said, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Then he goes on, and because you belong to him. Boy, I love the first part, but the second part starts to give me some money in the bank. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. What is my identity? My identity is this, that the power of Jesus Christ lives in me, and I do not have to be condemned over my past. I am set free to walk in the newness of life. How do I do it? Not through my power. I don't have the power to do it. I do it through the power of Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, shed his blood for us, who went to the grave, but the grave couldn't even hold him. And he come out of that grave and is now sitting on the right hand of the Father in heaven, making intercession for us. That is the identity that I have. I am a child of God. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise if you believe that. I belong to him. Man, that statement. I belong to him. The enemy wants to keep trying to tell me, no, you are bound up with the things that you have done in the past. No, 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 no. There can be no sin in Christ. There is no condemnation in him. So whenever I come to him, and if the enemy tries to beat me down, Christ is going, if you will look at me, if you will think about me, if you will read my word, you will build your faith. That's why I listen to other ministers. That's why I listen to praise and worship music. When the enemy gets me down, I don't go and listen to some, you know, country and western song that's going to, you know, take me out and get me all, oh my God, you know. Oh, Lord. And I say country and western because that's, you know, that's the big genre of music, you know, around here. And I like all genres of music. I listen to all kinds of different music. But let me tell you something. There's something about putting in and coming out. There's just something about it. When I'm down, I ain't gonna go listen to old Hank lift me up. Bo Cephas ain't got nothing for me then. When I'm down, I gotta get up. And can I tell you something? The more I stay away from him, the more I'll get down. And you'll get down so low sometimes you don't even realize you're down. Anybody ever been there before? Whoa, what is happening to me? I am in this major, Amen. What has happened? I have gradually moved away until I have spiritual, and this is something the Lord just dropped in my spirit. Yesterday I was writing some more at the house, and I just felt the Lord say, there's a lot of people with spiritual amnesia. Amnesia is partial or total memory loss. Some of us are dealing with spiritual amnesia. We forget who God is that brought us out of the chains of bondage of sin and death. We have forgotten the power that there is in being able to lift up the name of Jesus. Why do we prompt you to praise? Because the Bible tells us he inhabits the praises of his people. And one of our responsibilities, this team and myself, one of our major responsibilities on Sunday and on Wednesday night is to bring you in and remind you of the goodness of God. Because you've been in a world all day long that's trying to rob you of the blessings of God, trying to take that out of your mind, trying to tell you there ain't no God. God, this and that and everything else, and cussing going on around you, people talking about all the different things that's happening in their lives, and we, our job is to come in and go, hey, snap out of it. God's good. And I'm here to tell you today, you ready? Snap out of it. God's good. You need to remember him today. God's good. I've got to go around in my life and remind me why. Because the enemy is trying to put condemnation on me. But the Bible says, no, 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 you don't understand. There is no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. And for those who belong to him. And because you belong to him, the power, the life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. You know, I love reading after the Apostle Paul, just such a great writer. And I think it comes even more profound to me after having been this year in Rome, where we went and were actually in Paul's prison. I have in my office, my wife gave me at Christmas this last year. So it would have been last year we were in Rome. When my wife gave me something, it was at Christmas. I've got it hanging there, and it's probably one of the most precious things that she's given to me. And it is a picture that we took inside of Paul's prison, where he was there with the hole up there at the top that is gated over. And that's where they would have lowered him into this cell on a rope. They would have lowered him down into it. And from that hole in the top, they also would lower his food down to him. Now they've cut a way where you can come around and you can get in there. And it is from that place that Paul wrote to Timothy, I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. We stood up there above that prison cell after we had went in, and we read that passage of scripture, and we sang the chorus, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Then we sang, though none go with me, still I will follow. There's no turning back. And when I think about scriptures that Paul has written, when he's going through all of these things and all of the difficulties in prison, out of prison, it is in this same prison that Paul was pulled up, and we walked out and looked down the road that Paul would have been led down the road as he was getting ready to be beheaded. We're walking down those things, and I'm thinking, oh my God, the Apostle Paul walked these areas. And I think, oh, what a great man. Oh, I wished I could live up to some of the things that Paul has done. You know what that statement is? That's the condemnation of the enemy telling me I can never live up to what the Apostle Paul was. And you know what? That may be true in this life, but I'm doggone sure going to try it. I'm gonna give it everything that I've got to try and live up to that thing, because the enemy keeps telling me, no, you can't. No, you can't. And everything inside of me has got to go, yes, you can. I can do this. I can live a life that does not allow sin and the things to come in and weigh me down. Paul wrote in Galatians, do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage that Christ has set you free from. I'm here to declare to you today, some of you have walked in, and the enemy all this week, or maybe in the past months, have wrapped you up with chains of condemnation, chains of bondage, chains on your mind that's wondering, is God really real? Can God really do things in my life? I'm here to declare to you, as someone who has walked that same road, who has been down that same type thing, the God that I serve is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he did it for Paul, he'll do it for me, and he'll do it next week also. Come on and give God praise in the house. Romans chapter number 7, Paul writes this in verse number 21. I have discovered this principle of life. Now, when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. Anybody ever been there before? That's what I love about Paul. He's just so, well, this is just how it is. That what I want to do, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart. That's his word. But there is another power within me that is at war, where? With my mind. Where does the devil fight his biggest battle? In my mind. You may be sitting here today and have been battling something in your life, and the devil's going, you ain't going to be healed. You know that. You might as well just get ready. You're going to live with this. That's the devil in your mind. That's the devil telling you God's not big enough. He's trying to condemn you for thinking about a God who is able to heal and set free. But there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Anybody ever thought that? Okay, this is rough. If this is as good as it's going to get, this is bad. He goes on. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? And then I love this because there's an exclamation point beside it. You know what it means to me? Paul was going, who's going to deliver me from these patterns that are beating me up and trying to take me down? I just kind of think there might have been a pause here. That Paul began to sit there and all of a sudden go, wait a minute. Wait a minute. No, I'm not going to do this. Because the next statement has an exclamation. I believe he might have been doing this, writing, and then just stopped and went, wait a minute. And then he goes, thank God. Because there's an exclamation point there. The answer is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So you see how it is? In my mind, I really want to obey law, God's law. But because of my sinful nature, I feel I'm a slave to sin. Then he jumps right into chapter 8 and he goes, but there's no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, because I walk not after the power of the flesh, but after the power of God. He brought it all together. He said, these are the things that are going on in my mind. These are the things that are beating me up. But wait a minute. I remember when Jesus shed his blood for me and he come out of that grave, he took the wrath of the enemy away from me. Thank God. I'm free. I got to live in this world, but I'm not part of this world. I don't have to confess things like the world does. I don't have to believe things like the world does. I believe in Christ. He had to just come to that place. Pastor, you're getting a little excited. You think about the power of God, you get a little bit excited too. You see, I believe real quickly. And I'm not going to define all these because I know how I've sat there before, and when a pastor says, I've got 12 points, you start going, holy cow, does he realize what time it is? I've got 4 points real quick. And I'm going to do them in 10 minutes. I got amens on that. What is it that gives us our identity with Christ? I believe one of the main things that gives us our identity with Christ is the cross. The cross. When I remember what was done on the cross, I remember a couple of things. Number one, I remember the power that is available for me. I remember the life-giving power of a man that came out of a grave, of a man that appeared to the others that were there. The man, the power that he said, I'm leaving you, but I am sending another. His name is the Holy Spirit. He will not only be with you, but he will be in you. He is the one that whenever my mind starts going to those places, I call on the Lord, and the power of the Holy Spirit reminds me and helps me defeat the enemy. I'm not left alone. I have the Holy Spirit with me. Number two, the cross gives me a promise that this is not all that there is. I'm so thankful for that. This is not all that there is. And a lot of times we look and we say, well, if this is all there is to life, this is really bad. Let me tell you something. I'm not working for this life. I'm working for my heavenly life. Everything I have here, everything I own, is going to one day be gone. And I tell you what, anybody that's left can have anything that I have. Because in reality, there is no value to it. In reality, it is all, as Scripture would say, wood, hay, and stubble. That one day will be consumed and it'll all be gone. But because of the power of the cross, and because of the promise I have because of the cross, I don't live in the condemnation the enemy tries to place on me. Number three, there is a presence that comes. I don't always understand it. But there are times this week I was praying about something, and I was in my office, and it's some decisions that have to be made. And I was going, Lord, I really, really don't know what to do. I feel like this is the way that this should be going, but I've got to trust in you. And it was like the Holy Spirit just so sweetly reminded me, LaVon, I got this. I've got this. And I walked up here, and within 10 minutes, the Lord had opened the door to the answer that I needed in this situation. I wish they all happened that way. I wish they all happened in 10 minutes, but they don't. But you know what? I was sitting there, and this is what I know beyond a shadow of a doubt. That the power of God and the promises of God brings the presence of God. The power that there is in Him. When I remember who He is, when I go to the Word and I look at the promises, there is a presence that comes. And then outside of that presence, the last thing is, there is a peace that comes. There is a peace that comes. When I think about my identity in Christ, I realize it doesn't matter what happens to me, but it does matter what happens in me. And there is something that is shifting. There are some people that I really believe are hungry for the things of God like they've never been before. I'm going to ask our musicians if they'll come. I believe that God is doing some mighty things. You see, when we preach the cross, when we preach that thing, people go, you know, that's old school. That's this. And we've gotten so modern. We've gotten so technologically, you know, proficient in all of these areas that I think sometimes we think more about those things than we do the spiritual things. But God's been reminding me that we are spiritual beings. We have to be nurtured in our spirit. Today, as people were up here worshiping, and I love what Michael said. He said, you know what? You may be back there and you may be just tapping the back of the pew, or you may just be standing there worshiping. We've said this I don't know how many times. It's not about the art of worship. It's about the heart of worship. It's not about how I do it. It's about why I do it. There are introverts and there are extroverts. And a lot of the people that you see up here are former introverts that are just going, man, I just need something. And I'm going to step out here and put myself out there. I'm just going to go for it. You know, I've said it like this before. In worship, a lot of times, you know, you watch people And they come at different places in their worship. And I can tell you that there are so many people here that have worshiped in many different ways. You know, and my worship is different now than it used to be. Really, Pastor? Can it change? Yeah, it can. Because I've learned also in my life that it's not about who is around me. It's about who I'm doing this for. And everything I do is for an audience of one. An audience of one. And that is Jesus Christ. I can honestly say this. I hope today that you get something out of this message. And I hope today that in some way God talks to you. But the greatest thing for me is when I walk off of this platform and I turn off my iPad and I walk in to the room over to this side and get my stuff together and I feel the Holy Spirit go, good job, buddy. Good job. You said what I wanted you to say. I'll take it from here. And that's what I want to do when I come up here. I hope you enjoy the service. I hope you like the worship and those types of things. But I'm here, even though it's my job and my responsibility to minister on Sundays and Wednesdays and when we have gatherings. But I can honestly say, my daddy taught me this one time. I got so frustrated. I was leading worship with my father. And Sunday nights, I mean, we had a church that would seat 500, and there might be 75 or 100 in there. And it's kind of hard when there's pews in there, and you can't move them, and there's like 75 to 100 people scattered, and you're trying to lead worship. And I remember turning around one day and going to my daddy and saying, this is just crazy. I mean, we do everything we know to do, and only 75 people show up. And my dad looked at me, and he said, son, let me tell you something. We're not responsible for those who aren't here, but we are responsible to those that are here. And he said, we're going to preach and we're going to sing like this place was packed with standing room only. He said, because when we do it that way, we glorify God, and that's the reason that we're here anyway. You see, I hope today that when you walk out of here, that you go, you know what? I haven't got to live in condemnation. Christ lives in me. He lives in me. And I hope you can remember me going, hey, God loves you. Hey, you got power through Jesus Christ. Hey, quit wallowing around in the mud. Stand up. You're a soldier of the cross. The Bible tells me in 1 Corinthians 1 and 8, the message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved, we know it is the very power of God. I am crucified with Christ. It's not me that lives anymore, but I live through Christ. I live through Him. Every head bowed and every eye closed. You may be here today and you may be going through battles and struggles and situations in life. And you may say, Pastor, I'm just having a rough time. I want to remind you today that Jesus is here for you. That there is power in the cross. That there is power in the name of Jesus. That there is power through all that He does for us. And today, Christ loved you so much that He gave His life for you. Maybe you're here and the enemy has been condemning you. Maybe you're here and you feel like an individual that is worthless, useless. But today, Christ wants you to know that he loves you and his power is sufficient for anything you're going through. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, today I want to make sure my relationship with Jesus Christ, my identity, should he call us home today, I want my name written in that book in heaven, my identity in him sealed. I don't want it expired. I don't want it gone. I want to know. And I want today to renew that relationship so that I'll know beyond a shadow of a doubt that I am a child of God. If that's you today, we're not going to embarrass you or anything. I just want to pray with you. If that's you, would you just lift your hand where you're at? Yes, I see these hands going up. Yeah. Yeah. You can put your hands down. You know, it's a hard place. The enemy really messes with us when we're in that place. But today there is victory through Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I've been living under condemnation. The enemy keeps bringing up some things in my life, and I just need today to kind of give him a black eye and remind him there is no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, and I am one of those. Today, Pastor, will you pray for me? If that's you, would you just lift your hand? I want to pray with you this week. Yes, yes. Now, if you're here today, I'm going to ask our prayer team if they would to come quickly and just join us at the front, because I believe there's something powerful about having someone agree with you. Russell, if I can get some house lights, please. I just believe there is something important about having someone agree with you. And today, as they begin to sing this, I'm going to ask you, if you're here and you want prayer, to just come find one of these individuals and let them pray with you. Just come up if you're saying, I'm giving my life to Christ today. Come up and tell them that. They'll know how to pray with you. If you're here and you say, I'm just going through some real rough times and the enemy's been just condemning me and I've been walking in that, just come up and say, I need that assurance in Christ, and they'll pray with you. Because I believe that when we confess that, the Bible tells us confess our faults one to another so that we can be healed. Healed. God is in the healing business. So if that's you today, as they begin to sing, if you would, just come find someone.